So the next episode in our story about ConvNets is about going deeper. We'll look at residual networks, or ResNets. As I said before, much of the progress in ConvNets has been driven by scaling up. One obvious way of scaling up networks is by making them deeper. We've seen already that increasing the depth from 8 layers in AlexNet to 19 layers in V2G boosted performance quite substantially. However, we've also seen that training V2G was quite complex due to its depth. So in order to go even deeper, another innovation was necessary. And this is where residual networks come in. Their main innovation were the skip connections to create so-called residual blocks. A residual block looks as follows. We feed the input x through two convolutional layers to compute what's called f of x in the graph on the left. But then, instead of just stacking up more and more of those convolution layers, we add the skip connection that takes the input of the block x and adds it to f of x. So the convolution layers in the residual block are not transforming one feature representation into another, but rather they're computing the residual. That is the difference between the input to the block and what the output of the block should be. The main advantage of this approach is that it helps training very deep networks, since the gradients during backpropagation are much better behaved. To understand this point, let's look at the gradients in a very deep network. The network is essentially a composition of many simpler functions, the individual convolutions. The final output f of x is f1 of f2, f of 3 of x, etc. If we take derivatives by applying the chain rule, we see that the derivative of f of x is composed of the product of the derivatives of the individual functions. Now, if these derivatives are on average greater than 1, they will grow exponentially and training will diverge. On the other hand, if they're on average smaller than 1, they will shrink exponentially towards 0, and the learning signal, which is based on the gradient, will not reach the early layers. By adding the skip connections, this problem disappears, because every layer is more or less directly hooked up to the output and will therefore receive a gradient signal that doesn't first have to backpropagate through all the subsequent layers. And this simple trick enables training much deeper networks of up to hundreds of layers. In addition to the skip connections, ResNets made two important improvements over earlier architectures like V2G. First, they replaced the expensive first couple of layers by something more efficient. And second, they replaced the multiple fully connected layers at the end of the network by first performing a global average pooling and then adding only one fully connected layer that then requires much fewer connections. For the first couple of layers, consider V2G shown on the left. It turns out that about 50% of the compute in the entire network ends up happening in the first 4 layers. And the remaining 15 layers that follow them require around the same compute budget. And that's because these early layers, they operate at high resolution. ResNet, shown on the right, replaces those 4 layers by one single 7x7 convolution layer with a stride of 2 that is directly followed by a pooling layer. And the result here is a feature representation of the same resolution as after the 4th layer of V2G, but requiring much, much less floating point operations and memory. Okay, that's ResNet. For the exercise, we'll load a pre-trained ResNet, run a few images through the net, and inspect its predictions on a number of different images.